Hi, this is Susan Haynes, and it is October 2011. I want to talk about Huffman compression for my algorithms class as another example of a greedy algorithm. So we motivate compression by noticing that if I want to transmit a message, which is composed of a set of letters that form my alphabet, I need to create a code, a binary code, that I can use to do the transmission. So in this case, I have got six letters altogether. So with six letters, that means if I'm going to find a binary code for this, I'll need to have three bits. And the reason I need three bits is because if I have three bits, I can have eight unique patterns, right? If I only have two bits, I'll only have four unique patterns. And since I'm looking here with the size of alphabet of six, I'll have to have my eight unique patterns, and two of those patterns won't be used. So I'm going to take my three bits right here and use them to encode my chars that I'll be sending. I have a number of possibilities. Let me just pick any of them. It doesn't matter. Just keep it simple, I guess. So let me say I'll just start at zero and go up by one for every new char. Okay, so another pattern might be, how about something like this? As long as my code is unique, I'll be able to encode into the code, and then when the code is, the message is received on the receiver end, they'll be able to decode to a unique and original char. Okay, any message that I send using an uncompressed code will be three bits times the number of chars in the code. So the message length I'm going to have here will always be three times the number of chars in the message. Okay, that's for my uncompressed code. Now, that doesn't take advantage of these different frequencies. And we know that in the English language and in most other character-based alphabet systems, it's most common to have particular letters appearing much more frequently than other letters. So, for example, in the English language, the E is the most common letter. So that will have a higher frequency of appearing in a message. A letter like Q or Z will not appear as often, so that'll have a much lower frequency. And what you would like for efficiency is to have the really high frequency letters occupy only a few bits, and the low frequency letters occupy more bits, because the low frequency letters, this char won't appear as often. So if I need more bits to code it, that is more than offset by a high frequency letter only needing a few bits to encode. So one possible code that takes advantage of the different frequencies in letter is the Huffman code. So now I'm going to show how to go about creating the Huffman code. Let me give myself a little more room here. There we go. Okay, so the algorithm for the Huffman code works like this. You take each char, and then for each char you build one binary tree. And with a single node, and the value of the single node is the char. So here I've got a six single node binary trees. They're going to get jammed together here because I don't have a lot of room, but you'll see them turn into obvious binary trees in just a minute. Now each one of these trees right here I label with the frequency, and I'm going to start to call that frequency the weight. So this will have 0.4 weight, 0.35 weight, 0.1, 0.05, 0.05, 0.05, 0.05. Okay, now it's important that all these frequencies add up to one, and you know, it has to, because every letter will have some frequency associated with it if it's a valid letter in our alphabet. Okay, so to proceed now with the Huffman algorithm, I take the two, this is the greedy portion, I choose the two lowest weight trees to combine. So here I have a choice of which two to pick, and in terms of exercising the Huffman compression algorithm to get an optimum encoding, it doesn't matter which two I choose. I will get a different code book depending on which order I choose my trees in, but in terms of the efficiency, it'll end up being the same. Okay, so let me just choose those two because they're conveniently next to each other. And what I do is each of those trees, I've got a tree here and a tree here, each of those trees each become a subtree of a new tree with a new root right there. So the E tree becomes the left child and the F tree becomes the right child of my new node. And the new weight associated with that is just the sum of these two weights right here. So that's 0.10. And then the rest of my trees will remain the same. With the same weights. Okay, and the algorithm continues that way. I choose the two trees with the lowest weight, and so I've got 0.05 is the lowest, and then I can choose either this EF tree or this C tree. Let me choose this right here because it's convenient, again. So I have a new root, and so I'll have a left child and a right child. And the left child can either be this node right here or this root node right here. Again, the order of left to right doesn't matter, except that I'll get a different code book over here. So let me just do the simple thing. Let's see, this will be my D right here. Yep, there's my D, and this is my root node here with the two children E and F. And the weight of this tree is 0.15. The other trees remain the same. Okay, so now I continue and I see my two lowest weights are this C tree and this DEF tree. So I will combine those two into a new tree with a left child, which is C, and a right child, which is the root of this tree right here. So that's fine. D, E, and F. Okay, and the new weight of this is 0.25. Adding 0.5 and 0.1. A and B trees remain the same. Okay, let me continue this over here. So now I've got my two smallest trees are 0.35 and 0.25, so I combine those two. New root. Just for interest, I'll just flip the order that might feel more comfortable to you, just to show you it can be done okay with no problem. This tree needs to be put as the left child of my new tree, so I'll just copy that tree over. And this now has weight, 0.6. And then the A tree, of course, single node tree has weight 0.4. And so now when I go to my final tree, I combine my two smallest weights right there into a new tree. So here's my A right here. And then the right child will be this node right here. So let me copy everything else down. Oops, see, I'm getting a little ahead of myself. Okay, so here is the Huffman tree. And the way we, a Huffman tree, and the way we interpret this tree to create our code book is that when I have a new message that I'm trying to encode or decode, I start at the root of the tree with the beginning of the message. And then I follow the tree down, I follow the branches down to get to the node that I'm looking for. And if I'm trying to encode, the branches are labeled, the left branch gets labeled a 0 and the right branch gets labeled a 1 always. So I'm labeling the branches here so you can see them. Okay, so to encode the A, let's create my Huffman code up here for this particular tree. To encode the A takes only one bit, which is just great because that's the most common letter, and so it's got the shortest code. To encode the B takes a 1, 1. To encode the C takes 1, 0, 0. Do you see that? We start up here, right here, and then we go 1, 0, 0 for my C. Okay, to encode the D, we have 1, 0, 1, 0. To encode the E, I start up at the root here. I have 1, 0, 1, 1, 0. And to encode the F, I have 1, 0, 1, 1, 1. Okay, so that is my new code book. And we can see here that the very high frequency letters have shorter codes and the very low frequency letters have longer codes. So the F requires 5 bits and the B requires only 2 bits.